riffs are too repetitive, the lyrics make no sense. All the songs are B-sides and the cover art's a mess. There's so much here to tear apart. Listen to it for a week, now that we've passed. Why I hate this album podcast with Tim and Garrett.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Why I Hate This Album. I am one of your hosts, Garrett Harvey. With me as always, co-host extraordinaire Munchausen's, to my Munchausen's by proxy, Timothy Richardson. Tim, how you doing, buddy?
I'm sorry. Are you poisoning me?
Are you not?
No, I am.
Sure.
Are we both?
Well, I assume you've been poisoning yourself for attention. Or
I have,
at least
yes.
For the attention of medical professionals. Right. And I've been doing the same.
That's too much poison.
Probably. How much are you using?
Just below the maximum.
Well, if it helps, I'm using frog poison, so the ratios are much, much lower.
You might not be affecting me at all, then. I'm not
using
a
frog. It by the handful.
Oh, dear. Well, Garrett, let me tell you how I'm doing this week, unrelated to the knowledge that you're poisoning me. I feel both shame and regret.
That brings me both joy and curiosity. Tim, what's got you feeling so reflective?
Well, Garrett, last week we discussed who I would be if I could be like that, if I could live one day in your shoes.
Sure.
And I have to admit something, Garrett. I lied to you.
Well, that's unsurprising, but
no,
let's elaborate.
No. I left out some major information because my face had been savagely beaten by some goons, and I was worried about annoying you with what you would probably call nonsense and incurring a slap, it would further damage my various facial tissues.
Sure. You had a lot on your mind on account of the Columbia House goons that had visited you earlier in the week.
Right. All that is to say, of course, that I have been like that because, you see, Garrett, I belong to the authority of Tim, an organization that includes all Tims worldwide. So, you know, and Tims are busy people, Garrett. Sometimes we need to fill in for each other. So, for example, I have directed approximately 1 minute and 6 seconds of the final product of Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street, because one afternoon Tim Burton needed a root canal. It's just one example. So like Tim Meadows filled in for Tim Robbins for a night on his honeymoon with Susan Sarandon.
No.
But listen, he needed just a goddamn hour or two to himself, and I get it. I still get residual checks for my part in the invention of the World Wide Web when I briefly was Tim Berners-Lee. I mean, you know, if I'm being honest, my only real contribution was we should make this alliterative. But my point, Garrett, is that I have been many other people. They just all happen to have been named Tim. So I apologize to you. Also, please don't slap me now.
Yeah, you know what, Tim? Honestly, I want to slap you. Obviously.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Yeah.
Because I do. It just shows
it.
Me you're.
I get it.
You're not present in the episode, right? You're not. You're not hearing me. You're not thinking. You're focusing too much on your notes, but that's okay because.
No, honestly, I was focusing too much on the savage beating I had gotten earlier.
Sure. Sure. And again, entirely your fault for impersonating me. But the reason I'm not upset this week is because I want to thank you for that brief moment that you were, in fact, Tim Berners-Lee during the burgeoning years of the internet. Your idea to go with World Wide Web over what I believe was choice number two, Information Superhighway, has made websites much easier to navigate, especially in those early years. I much prefer a www to a ish.com. That way, ish.nike.com. No, sounds terrible. www, that's
in
the move.
In all honesty, ish was the third choice. Yeah, second choice was simply the computers.
The second choice was the computers.
Well, yeah, that's why we didn't pick it, you see.
How is that two over Information Superhighway? That's my confusion.
Wait, it's not real. I mean, at that point, the internet was very slow, Garrett. I would not describe it as a superhighway.
I digress. Tim, what song have we been listening to for an entire week straight?
We have been listening to Four Non-Blondes' possibly only song, What's Up?
You know what, Tim?
I think you're right.
I'm curious, after an entire week of listening at the top of the show before we get into the nitty gritty, Tim, do you hate this song?
No.
Wow.
No, not yet. I might by the end of this, because we're probably going to listen to it 3 or 4 more times as we discuss it. But what about you, Gary, my boy? Do you hate this?
No, no, sir. No,
do
I don't.
Love
in fact,
this?
Don't love. Oof. God, I really like this song.
Ugh.
I'm ashamed of it. I know. I'm listeners. I'm wrong. I get it. I'm not even going to defend defend it this week, not even coming from a place of authority. I'm wrong. And I'm going to see if I can get there this week. There's a good chance, Tim. But let's not jump ahead. As of right now, no, I do not hate it. But we'll see if that can change. Before we can get there, though, I'm curious, Tim. Prior to this week, what is your experience with these Blondes, Non, and their song, What's Up?
Well, I've heard this song numerous times. I had no idea who it was by. I had no idea what it was called. If you had put this song on and asked, I would have probably guessed that this was the Cranberries covering an Alanis Morissette song. Maybe vice versa. But either way, we've talked about Linda Perry a number of times. I was aware of this band. I was aware of Linda Perry. I was aware of this song. Never put them together.
Fascinating. You learned a lot this week.
Sure. Yes. I'm not 100% sure I was alive when this came out.
No, you definitely were.
I'm not sure I was in this country when this came out.
You were not.
Okay. Garrett, I assume you've heard this song before this week.
Yes. Yes, I have. I heard it when it was on the radio incessantly. I downloaded it off of Napster as soon as I could. It's been on many a burned CD. Amazon Music thinks that it would be a great suggestion for me, no matter what station I pick. I can't avoid it. I loved this song when it came out. Less so these days. Don't really put it on of my own fruition much. But Tim, it was a hot song when I was a kid, and that nostalgia runs deep. It's hard for me to shake. Objectively, again, folks, I get it. I'm wrong. That's okay. It's okay to like music nobody else likes. Most of the music Tim and I like, well, not nobody else likes, but a lot of people don't like it. That's fine. Don't care. I don't think we say that enough on the show, Tim, because we occasionally get reviews or emails or tweets or God knows what from various fans or sometimes the bands themselves, and they're furious. We're not
sometimes they're
to...
lighthearted. John Gurley of the Portugal The Man seemed to enjoy our take on his bad album.
Sure. And you know what, Tim? That was episode, one, two?
Three.
Two?
It was supposed to be number one, but you did not bother to record your half of the recording. And as a result, we had to scrap it and start again.
As I recall, you spilled Cavassier on the tape.
I did.
And it was ruined instantly.
Yes, but there was no Garrett part on the tape. I spilled Cavassier on the tape out of anger, not accident.
Agree to disagree. And moving on, Tim, that's my history. That's your history, or lack thereof. Take us on a journey. Help us understand. Before we can talk about the song, we need to understand a little bit about the people who made it. So who are these non-blondes for, and how did What's Up come to be?
Well, the most important non-blonde, Linda Perry, future vocalist and alleged non-blonde, was born to the Portuguese and the Brazilians in Springfield, Massachusetts, and liked playing various instruments and such as a child. At some point in her teens, she moved to San Diego, played guitar, got some non-specific kidney disease, got addicted to non-specific drugs. She was bad at school. She was unsuccessful auditioning for a series of girl bands and cover bands. Then in a truly unique move, she moved to San Francisco in 1986 to get clean, and it worked.
What?
Yeah, the first part is dumb. The second part is truly astounding.
Yeah, that's fascinating. That's wow. I mean, I guess I was going to say maybe San Francisco in the 80s is a much easier place to get clean than obviously San Francisco in, say, the 60s or 70s for that matter. But honestly, I don't think anybody was getting clean in the 80s, no matter where you were.
Sure.
Let alone San Francisco.
Absolutely. Meanwhile, future lead guitarist Shauna Hall and lead bassist Christina Hillhouse were roommates in San Francisco. They joined a band with lead drummist Wanda Day, and then they broke up with that band. Those three stayed together and basically abandoned everyone else that was already in that band. They met Linda Perry, and in lieu of a good nickname, let's just call her Larry. L. Perry. No,
Linda
Larry.
Oh, I like it.
Oh,
Larry. Tim, you've hit on something great this week. Linda Perry, from henceforth, will be Larry.
Anyway, they met at Nightbreak nightclub in 1989. Their first band practice was interrupted by the 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake. That was the one that happened during the World Series. That might be an apocryphal story. I think my brother-in-law was actually at that World Series game, and that's not an apocryphal story unless he was not there.
Well.
In which case,
yep,
it is.
That would be the definition. Nailed it.
Like every good band we discuss, this band too has a very, very great name origin story. Larry and the girls were sitting next to a trash can, and what Christina Hillhouse described as a blonde family came by, and there was a piece of trash pizza sitting atop that trash can, and one of the kids wanted to eat that, tried to eat it. And the mom said, no, it's probably dirty, what with the pigeons and people, and then stared right at this band's. And, okay, that's obviously never happened, and it's ridiculous to even claim that that happened, but that is why they say they call themselves non-blondes. And also, because they clearly made this story up, this is sort of their opinion on how people see them. So they're some sort of garbage pigeon people.
Well, yes, absolutely. I also want to circle back around to the phrase blonde family.
That seems a little bit offensive too, right?
Anytime you can make a categorization like that, I immediately try to think of somebody using said categorization as an insult. Just like, get out of here, you fucking blondes! Like, huh.
Well, okay. We've discussed this before. Right. Blonde is an uncommon and, I don't want to say unsightly, but it's not an ideal hair color for an adult male, right?
Well, sure. Absolutely. Okay. That does not condone any sort of authority or, I don't know, sense of direction.
Right, sure.
You, Tim, are more of a clear-headed boy, right?
Well, only when my hair is very short. Once it becomes longer, it turns brown again. The point is that...
Brown is what you call that, eh?
It is, yes. It is the color of my scalp when very sunburnt. It's neither here nor there. The point is...
So you don't have so much brown hair as you do a tanned head.
A sunburnt skull, I think.
Wow, what color is your hair? I guess it's brown, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I guess I knew you when you would spend more time outdoors. I would have said it was like a dark, like a dirty blonde.
It's like blonde. A dusty brown, I think. Is that fair? I spend a lot of time outdoors, Garrett. What do you mean?
Yeah, but you wear hats.
Oh, yes. I always wear a hat. I'm very sensitive to the sun. Anyway.
On account of that clear hair.
What are we talking
He's
about?
He's the anyway, faceless the- man. Man, we're going to get you a comic strip. You're going to be some sort of noir superhero like the Shadow. Well, the faceless man.
Yeah.
No mask, no costume. It's just you.
I would be a very successful criminal.
Oh, yeah. I mean, some would say you are.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm the sort of person, like, this is, again, just a hypothetical, but like,
sure.
At the scene of a strangling, one could strangle another person
specific.
And then just step back into the crowd. And who's going to find that guy? It could be anyone. Could be everyone.
Completely agree. Could be everyone. It's definitely just one guy, though. I just a piece of advice, Tim. Take it or leave it. My two cents. Not here to tell you how to live. In your hypotheticals, just consider this. Go more generic.
Don't list things that I can be proven to have done.
There's a good start. I was even going to keep that pretty generic and just say you could have said a murder.
Yep, I could have. Mm. But you've always told me that comedy is built in specifics.
Sure, absolutely. So are indictments.
Anyway, after they were named by a woman telling her son not to eat rat-infested
pizza. Tim, you can
pizza.
Say it. It's okay. A blonde.
Yeah, after a filthy blonde named these women, they started playing around San Francisco, mostly in lesbian bars, and they had a huge lesbian following. They opened for Primus in 91, right after which they got signed to Interscope Records. They fired the drummer and hired my paternal aunt, Dawn Richardson, to replace her, and set to recording their debut and also farewell album, Bigger, Better, Faster, More, which was released in 1992.
Do we have confirmation on that being the farewell album?
It's the only released album, but it may consist of just one song. I don't know. It might be a single.
I was just clearing up if it was a presumed single album or if it was actually confirmed.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm not going to do a bit here, Garrett. This is very serious material.
Ooh, I feel like the history last week was filled with dramatizations.
Well, we only have to say that it was filled with dramatizations for legal reasons. That all happened.
Well, the multi-man high fives?
I will not let you cast doubt on my telling of high fives. Garrett, you know that I am a high five scholar. I spent 4 years of college studying the high five.
Sure. Studying, perfecting, refining.
Yes. Not getting a degree. Anyway, Garrett, during the recording of that album, they fired the guitarist, Shauna, and got somebody named Louis Metoyer to finish the recording. And they toured on that album. They recorded some one-offs for things like Wayne's World 2 and Airheads. And then they broke up while recording their second album. Larry said she was basically very unhappy with the first album, didn't really care for the production, and there was a lot of tension as to how Larry was very out in comparison to the rest of the band. A bunch of interpersonal relationships and such didn't really work out.
Tales all this time.
Anyway, original drummist Wanda Day played with Malibu Barbie and some other bands, but then she broke her back and crushed her legs in an accident and eventually died in 1997. Hall performed
Jesus Christ,
with
Tim,
a bunch
maybe
of
a little less jaunty. God damn it, dude.
Hall performed with a bunch of people afterward, perhaps most strangely, George Clinton and Parliament Funkadelic, and Hill House has spent her time running the Four Non Blondes website to this very day. Now,
that seems like a waste of time.
Yes. Larry has obviously had the best post Non Blondes career, both as a producer and performer. So she started Rockstar Records, and it shocks me that that name was still available in 95.
Right?
Like, how's that?
Nobody thought of that.
I don't know. She released the solo album In Flight in 1996. Now, this album, Garrett, has great album art and some very mediocre music. She produced the film Pink as the Day She Was Born in 97, and then she wrote some songs that would go on to be on Christina Aguilera's album Stripped. In 2000, Pink asked her to help write some music, and she ended up writing and producing a lot of Misunderstood. Misunderstood. Oh, wow. She went on to co-write some of Gwen Stefani's Lobster Asshole Martini Baby and has subsequently played on albums written for, produced, etc. Worked with Jewel, Courtney Love, Alicia Keys, Celine Dion, Solange Knowles, James Blount, Cheap Trick, Enrique Iglesias, somebody named Yeezy Ferrari that I'm pretty sure is Guy Fieri, aka Smash Mouth, Faith Hill, Britney Spears, Unwritten Law, Adele, Miley Cyrus, Dolly Parton, and of course, Rivers Cuomo.
Jesus Christ. She's doing all right.
She's doing fantastic. In 2015, she was inducted into the Songwriter Hall of Fame alongside, and brace yourself for this group, Toby Keith, Cyndi Lauper, Robert Hunter, Jerry Garcia, and goddamn Willie Dixon. That is a list of people, other than Robert Hunter and Jerry Garcia, obviously, that is a list of people that don't have anything in common.
They're all songwriters.
Shut up. Anyway, but that's this band. They were a band for like 2.5 years. They didn't really like the music that they made. Then they stopped making that music and made bad solo albums, except for Larry, who made bad solo albums and was a very famous writer and producer and continues to be to today.
Yeah. I believe she allowed at least one, if not multiple artists we've covered on this show, come and live with her.
Oh, yeah. She pulled a real Usher on some people, except I think less predatory. Not saying allegedly. Easy. Allegedly. Not saying that Usher is predatory. I'm just saying it feels predatory.
Well, sure. I don't think she found these people on the internet. That's what he did.
Yeah.
He found a boy on the internet and then brought that boy to his home.
Yes. Steven Tyler did the same thing pre-internet.
Tim, he went to his lawyer and said, what do I need to do to be able to travel with an underage girl for the intents of sex? And he said, oh, the only way you could probably get away with that is if you adopted her. And he said, okay, get that put together then.
Listen, the lawyer and Steven Tyler are some real terrible people.
Mm-hmm.
Those parents, though, Garrett.
Good point. That's a great point. And okay, let's make real clear. Let's just live in a scenario where nobody had ill intentions. Based on the track record of other people with similar stories, one parent may infer this is probably not a great idea.
More so than that, look at Steven Tyler. Don't let that guy take your child.
Oh, right. I wasn't even considering that. I was only focusing on the Usher piece because the other one is a sex daughter.
Fair enough. It's in the title. I think the whole point of all of this talk is that Linda Perry didn't do that. She was nice and let people live with her while they started a career.
Help people start a career.
Right.
Thank you, Larry. Okay, Tim. Here's a little taste of What's Up by Four Non Blondes.
Pretty good.
Pretty good.
It's not, though. It's not good.
Okay. It's coming from the perspective...
Easy.
Coming from the perspective that I have, understanding... Guys, I'm wrong. But I like it, okay? So coming from that perspective, and you understand that, and I am willing to be converted, Tim, take me through it. What's wrong with this song? And also, please, if you can, try to be nice, give it a couple compliments as well.
Okay. Musically, it's fine. It's dated.
Okay.
It's fine. Mm-hmm. It's sure. Very banal. There, you got the like acoustic guitar, some electric over it, kind of down in the mix. It feels like it was written by a producer trying to emulate the sound of Blind Melon.
Okay, I could see that.
I don't care for her voice. Now,
there's
nothing wrong with her voice. I mean, she kind of sounds like a female Steven Tyler in not the best way. Speaking of Steven Tyler.
Is there a song that
not
speaks
really.
To you?
It's just whenever he tries to really go for it, it kind of sounds like what she's doing when she really tries to go for it. The real problem, though, that I have with her voice isn't necessarily her voice. It's that this song comes off as if she did four different takes. She decided, I haven't quite got a handle on what this song is, how I should be singing it. So like every verse, every chorus, I'm going to do a little bit differently. I'm going to change my voice up to kind of see if I can figure out this song. And then we'll go back and we'll re-record it and I'll do it all in that one vocal style. And then they just forgot to do that second part. And you just get like four, like she's doing like vocal impressions of stuff and she's doing like voices.
I see what you mean. So it's not that they're stacked. They're end to end. So it's one style 1 minute, one style the next.
Yes, and there's no real explanation for why it would change during the song.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's fair. That is in there. For me, it works. No, I'm kidding. I get it. It's dated. It's very specific. I'm trying to isolate a delivery that maybe would make the song work better if they stuck to that the entire time, but I don't know that there is a singular one that's better than the others.
No, absolutely not. I agree with that completely. There's not one that's better than the others, but one is better better than four.
I agree. No, I see. Maybe if they stuck with the more quiet approach and less of the going for it, as you mentioned. I get it. That's fair. I'm kind of running through it in my mind. I'm a little embarrassed. I've never really picked up on it. But you're right. She is shouty at one parts. She's quiet at others. Does get a bit of a Shannon Hoon in parts.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
If Shannon Hoon was singing this song, I think I'd probably like it.
Well, sure. Anything extra we could get would be nice. That's true. But no, I get what you mean. It would definitely improve it. You've really made me wonder. I'll never do this. Well, I might. No, I never will. I would have liked to have found some live versions of this song because there's a good chance that it's a little more even keel and less stylistically diverse.
It's odd though how much hate this gets because it's frequently on these like top, you know, one hit wonders bands of all time kind of things, but it's also frequently on these like worst songs ever lists.
Most hated, worst songs. I don't understand that at all.
Yeah, I agree. Because it's one of these songs that it very much belongs to like 92. Sure. And in the context of 92, sure, whatever. It's fine.
Now, I will say, as we're going to see, it's about nothing.
Well, that's true. Yeah, absolutely. So can I read to you bassist Christina Hillhouse? Because she has a very interesting story, Garrett. A very interesting story about when she heard this for the first time.
Well, Tim, I love that you've asked because it implies that I could hear save us all what is typically going to be a terrible story.
No, I said it's a good story.
Sure, I heard what you said. It implies that I could say no, and that would be fantastic. But I know that you're being polite, so just go ahead and read this ridiculous quote.
If you say no, I'm going to say it anyway.
No, was that not clear?
No, I apologize. Anyway, for a short time, Larry had quit her job, and she was living with me in this little two-bedroom flat in San Francisco. She wrote the song when she was in a room down the hall. I was in my bedroom having sex, and I stopped because I heard her playing the song. I remember running down the hall and saying, "Dude, what are you playing? I like that." We had a lot of rock, thrashy stuff back then, but Linda always would pull her ballads out. I remember being struck by it. She kept looking at me and going, "Does this sound like something? Am I plagiarizing someone?" And I said, "Finish the song. It's beautiful." It caught on at her shows right away. People really liked it, and then presumably went back to having some pretty cool sex.
I would argue that sex wasn't pretty cool if she stopped to listen to a song.
If she was doing the vocals like this and you were having sex, you're gonna stop and go, I don't know.
Is she yodeling? Are you yodeling or dying?
Is there a raccoon involved? What's happening? Jesus Christ. Okay? Also, I think it's funny that they called this What's Up. I assume they did that to not call it What's Going On to avoid a lawsuit from the estate of Marvin Gaye. Although, can you sue?
No.
Like, you can't sue for calling a song What's Going On.
No, not at all. They did purposely make it What's Up, though, just so that it has a chance of ever being purchased.
Oh.
Or being purchased by people not looking for What's Going On.
That's probably more accurate, yeah.
Smart move. Although I remember as a child learning that it was called What's Up and being like, guys, it's right there. What the fuck? Anyways, great. That covers the music. I think we're ready for lyrics, Tim. You ready for some lyrics?
I am.
All right, I'm going to kick us off. 25 years and my life is still trying to get up that great big hill of hope for a destination. I realized quickly when I knew I should that the world was made up of this brotherhood of man. For whatever that means, let's stop there. Obviously, right out the gate, it's the story of a 25-year-old who thinks that they should have made it, which anybody who is older than 25 will realize, that's not so bad.
Yeah, it's ambitious. And in all honesty, you shouldn't be peaking at 25.
Yeah, I peaked at 14, and I'll tell you what, I wish I'd known.
Yeah, I wish I could tell you. That would be a very funny conversation.
I mean, how you would have to tell me at like 12, though, so I could do some planning.
Oh, no. I want to tell you at 14. I want to find a 14-year-old Garrett in, 1982 and say, this is as good as it's going to get. It's all downhill. You're going to grow into a man and a boy that hasn't been born yet. You're going to befriend him. You're going to take him in. It's going to be weird. No. People are going to talk about it on the internet. Ooh, invest in the internet. I don't know how you do that, but do that. Anyway, they kind of seem to admit right up front, though, that this doesn't mean anything, right? Because the first one ends with, for whatever that means. It seems to indicate that it's just kind of a bunch of, like, word salad.
Oh, see, I took it to mean when she was saying that the world was made up of this brotherhood of man.
Oh.
That sounds really good, but when you get down to it, it's a brotherhood of men. It's a boys' club.
Oh, I think it works as sort of a meta thing. The first verse doesn't mean anything.
Okay. Either one's completely fine, Tim, because this song, very, very loosely held together.
Yes. Also, does she miss her cue and start singing late?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's something.
It seems like she comes in late. I don't know if she actually does, but feels like
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean. So I want to give an alternate theory because this song's pretty light, and I don't think this is what the song's about per se, but let's keep it a little more general for a moment. Let's assume we don't know who this story is about. So somebody for 25 years has been striving to do something, getting up that great big hill for a destination. They realize quickly, though, that they knew they should, that the world is made up of a brotherhood of man. So this brotherhood of man has halted this person or character's goals for the last 25 years. And let's just leave it there for a moment.
Illuminati.
Nope. What? Don't hijack my story.
No. The brotherhood of man is Illuminati. And the reason that, Garrett, you cannot get ahead is because they're holding you back. They have set a series of obstacles, societal obstacles in place that are preventing you from getting ahead, that they keep you as their cattle and they feed off of you.
The royal you or me specifically?
I mean, you are a part of this, certainly, but it is bigger than just you.
I have asked you to keep all of these stories to your podcast we don't release.
These are... we're releasing those. I figured out the
internet.
The World Wide Web, if you will. No, as Lacastier, you are going to make use of all of these things. You're just going to get to the other side. So 25 years, sure, you didn't make it. But by 45, by 55, you're going to be living high in the hog. You'd be sitting atop a pile of Illuminati bones, a throne, really.
I'm so confused. How does that have anything to do with the Illuminati?
They're running the world now. When you run the world, you're going to have to murder them all and sit atop their bones.
Well, Tim, I am not going to sit here and cop to a murder I have yet to plan. But let's just say anybody that stood in my way, sure, they're going to be defeated. Now, whether they end up graciously conceding in a democratically elected fashion or the latest addition to my bone pile, I don't care. Either one's fine.
I feel like they're probably all eventually going to end up in a chair of some sort.
Oh, God. Some sort of Ed Gein-like bone chair. Moving right along, the song continues. And so I cry sometimes when I'm lying in bed, trying to get it all out, what's in my head. And I am feeling a little peculiar. And so I wake in the morning and I step outside and I take a deep breath and I get real high and I scream from the top of my lungs, what's going on?
This also feels a lot like she was just reading it for the first time because there's these weird pauses in here. There's part like this is sung like you see a child who's written a sign like in a basketball game where it starts off real big and then you realize you don't have enough room and it all runs down. It's weirdly paced.
Yes, it is uneven throughout that entire section that I read. At some points, the verse or bar, depending on who you talk to, is drawn out. And then another time, she rushes it, as you said, Tim, from the top of my lungs, what's going on? Like that. Yeah. It's taking so much to not sing this song at your face, but I won't. I'm going to show
you
some restraint this week.
You can sing the chorus if you want.
Yeah, but I'm raspy. Anyway, to me, it sounds like somebody who is frustrated. They're lying in bed just trying to get all these thoughts out of their head, but they're feeling a little peculiar. Now, at this point, I was thinking, what if we're dealing with some sort of venom situation?
Oh, poisoned by chemtrails. I like it. By the Illuminati. Go on.
I don't think we're speaking the same language at all this week. I am talking about a symbiotic, completely sentient, and let's face it, based on the latest movie, humorous, alien-type character that has been attempting to take over the world for the last 25 years and is living inside of this person, and you're getting both sides of the personality, Tim. One side, of course, the symbiote trying to take over the world, frustrated that she's constantly thwarted by this brotherhood of man. Who knew that was here? And
everyone,
then, of course, the singer.
For 1,000 years, Garrett.
Well, not aliens.
What? Oh,
aliens.
Yes. Oh, okay. Yeah, you're right. You're right. Aliens would not be aware of the Illuminati. Yes.
God damn it. Is it? Okay. So I at least now understand why this keeps coming up. Here's the issue. I'm saying brotherhood of man. You're hearing secret society. Is that about right?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm thinking perhaps either we've got sort of an alien or alien abduction situation or the venom thing, and you're getting the host body as well, you know, lying in bed, trying to get all these crazy venomy thoughts out of their head, screaming what's going on, maybe getting high, trying to numb the pain of this alien that's constantly trying to eat people around them. I don't know, Tim. What do you think here?
Could be. Could also be, you know, somebody who's just trying to deal with their place in society with this boys club or you know, secret society.
Sort of a Unabomber situation.
I'm sorry?
You know, lying awake at night in their cabin, trying to figure out what's going on, getting these voices out of their head. I don't know.
I don't think the Unabomber was defeat schizophrenic.
Really?
I don't think so.
There was something going on.
Yeah, no, listen, he wasn't a pleasant guy, but I mean—
He also may have had some mental problems caused by that old MK Ultra. He was definitely part of the Harvard LSD experiments.
Hmm.
They broke that young man's brain. Not saying it's the only reason he started mailing bombs to people. And again, we firmly are in the don't mail bombs to people camp here on the show.
And honestly, if that needed to be said. Don't mail anything unpleasant. Don't mail your poop to people. Certainly not to us.
Don't even, listen, definitely don't go to the grocery store, purchase 4 large cans of cream of mushroom soup, heat them up ever so slightly past room temperature, load them into a package, and then ship them across the country. Don't do that.
That's yes. Did you do right. that?
No, of course not. I just got done telling you not to do
okay.
that.
Okay. And I said, hey, AA, hey, AA. I said, hey, what's going on? And I say, hey, AA, hey, AA. I say, hey, what's going on?
What's going on?
This drives me crazy. It's somebody that is trying to get attention, demanding you listen to her. She has something to say, something important, maybe something that will make you like reevaluate your life or change your perspective on the world. Listen to what this person is going to say. She's been lying awake. She's struggling with this and she knows what she's going to say. Hey, hey. And then there's just, there's nothing.
What's going on?
It's empty. It's meaningless. Like you're alive. Oh, no, that's probably not what she's saying. There's no revelation is my point.
I think the big revelation is, what's going on?
Yeah.
I mean,
do you think she was a fan of the Martin Gaye song, What's Going On?
Well, yeah, I do, because she's musically very talented, and how could you possibly not be aware of that song?
Did I say Martin? Marvin.
You might have said Martin.
Marvin Gaye.
Not his cousin, Martin Gaye.
Yes.
Wildly untalented.
The point, though, is that, okay, sure, how could somebody in this position not be aware of that song? Because that song is very, I mean, the whole album has a very distinct point.
Sure, but I would not say in any way, aside from 3 words, does this song have any sort of bearing or attempt to have any sort of bearing to resemble that song.
I'm not saying it's copying it. I'm just saying, like, why would you go anywhere near that?
Well, sure. Okay. As an educated person making, what do you and I know? This song, we haven't gotten to how it did
yet. Are you going to say suspect. This song came out first? Because I swear to God, Garrett, I might have to slap you.
No. That would be an amazing argument that I wish I could make. But I didn't prepare. No, what I was going to say is, if you and I were writing a song and I were to write this exact song, you'd be like, yeah, it might sell okay. I mean, the Cher singing is weird because she does do that.
And oh, yeah.
Oh, my God, do I try?
I forgot about that.
Yeah. Anyway, that aside, if I were to write this song exactly, you'd be like, I mean, even if people love it, it's going to be hard to get past the what's going on of it all.
Sure.
And I'd say, you know what, Tim? You're right. That's what I was worried about. Thank you for being a good friend and songwriter.
Just call it what's up and we'll move past it.
Well, here's the thing. We would have been wrong, I guess. I don't know how this did, but based on how often it was on the radio, I mean, it was 1993's Kryptonite.
Absolutely. Yeah. It does sound like Cher in verse 2. Garrett, it sounds like she gave, like, every verse and chorus was sung by a different member of this band. And it seems like they were all sung in isolation, like with, they did not discuss how they were going to perform it beforehand.
No need.
But it's all one person.
Just freeform, man.
Yeah. Because the song is ultimately pretty meaningless. So I think that's what I hang the vast majority of my opinion on this. What are they doing?
It's mindless pop.
Yeah, that's fair.
Anyway, let's keep going though.
Mm-hmm.
And I try. Oh my God, do I try. I try all the time in this institution and I pray. Oh my God, do I pray. I pray every single day for a revolution. I'll let you go first.
Again, I think what she's trying to say is that being female and gay in the early 90s, it's not getting her ahead.
Wasn't easy.
Yeah.
It wasn't opening a lot of doors, and hey, that's fucking true.
Yeah, that's fair.
I'm sure it didn't feel this way, Tim, but compared to 1993, by today's standards, there was a bit of a revolution. She kind of got what she wanted.
Yeah.
Like, look at Lil Nas X. I was going to say, I don't think anybody would bat an eye at having a very famous pop star that was gay, and Lil Nas X kind of proves it. He's the ambassador for Taco Bell, for God's sake. You can't get a chalupa without looking at that guy's face, and probably chaps.
Did you hear he had some speech at some,
uh-oh,
I'm going to say the VMAs. I don't know. It probably wasn't
we'll say that.
I don't. Yeah, sure. But whatever. He had some speech fairly recently where he just repeatedly thanked the gay agenda.
That's hilarious, man.
Oh, he might be a genius. I'm just going to throw that out there.
He really might be. I almost want to go back and redo Old Town Road because I don't know that we paid the man his due.
I think we should do that gay Satan song. Maybe watch that music video a couple of times.
I Honestly, I thought we had.
No, we talked about it in the news. You described it pretty well.
Okay, so I have seen it.
His SNL performance a number of times.
Oh, yeah, his dick came out. Never not funny. Okay, so for me, Tim, just for funsies, I kept the whole narrative going. Second verse could be the perspective of that alien who's trying. Oh, God, does he try within this institution of man. And he's praying every single day for an alien revolution where he takes over. I couldn't help but be reminded of, what's that terrible John Travolta movie? Battleship Earth.
Oh.
Keeps trying to take over Earth.
It's maybe not a great Forrest Whitaker movie, but a good Forrest Whitaker movie. It is a great Barry Pepper movie.
It's a fantastic Barry Pepper movie. It might be the best Saving Private Ryan's obviously the best Barry Pepper movie, but this has to be the second best.
Mile's pretty good.
Didn't really get all the
Yeah, you know what? You know what? You're right. That is a better movie, but this is a better Barry Pepper movie.
Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
I really like, he's got this very angular face.
Pepper?
Yes. B-pep?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He's Canadian, you know.
Interesting. I wouldn't have guessed that with such a Southwestern name. Hmm. Anyway.
Well, I mean, he became, obviously he's a naturalized U.S. citizen, but he was, you know, sure, originally Canadian.
The dream of every Canadian.
Sure. Anyway, but I think that this, again, if it is an alien, Garrett,
we're going to get some letters on that one. the dream of every Canadian. And I do mean letters. I don't know what's going on.
Which
they're
is
always handwritten,
which is confusing. I guess that they have somebody download the episodes and bring them in on a flash drive. I don't know how they're listening to it, but they do write letters.
Maybe the CBC broadcasts our podcast over radio.
I like that.
Yeah, that would be Canadians. Write in heypodmail@gmail.com. How are you listening to the show without the internet?
Are we on the radio there?
Yeah. Are we radio stars? What does that mean? Ugh, Canada. Right in.
Anyway, all right. So this alien, obviously, he's trying all the time. He's trying to get into the institution because he doesn't know. He's here, but it's not that. Why do you want to fight the Illuminati, Garrett? Just join them. If you had an option of overthrowing the Illuminati, or, I mean, I know what you would do because you want to be some sort of weird Lacoste, what are you talking about? But like a normal person, you just join them. It's easy. You don't cause a revolution. That's a Garrett move. You insert yourself at a low level and sort of work your way up through the background until eventually you're sort of a middle manager Illuminati. You know, a Tim move.
Yeah, total Tim move. You don't rock boats.
Nope.
But nobody rocks yours either.
That's right. I mean, look, it's a nothing song. It's got nothing to actually say. The real draw, I think, is the vocal styling, which I personally don't care for. I can kind of see why some people would, but the song doesn't really have anything I'm interested in. It seems like something that Larry needed to get out of her system before going on to have just a phenomenal career producing and writing and such. But I feel like she needed this to be like, okay, well, that's the best I'm ever going to do as a front man. And it was weird. Yeah, I'll write some songs for some other people. It'll be cool.
I concur.
Love or lobster as asshole martini baby something.
Yeah, we really need to revisit Miss Stefani.
Not that album.
And
right?
No. Well, maybe. The song wraps up with the outro that's pretty much the same thing as the intro. 25 years and my life is still yada yada.
Oh, there's a lot of oohs. There's oohs and ahs and uh-huhs in here that we didn't mention. Lots of those, and they're warbled to shit.
Yeah, there is a mild half orgasm in the latter third of this song, and it's fine, I guess.
Yeah, it's not the best I've ever heard.
Sure. Not. What? No, you know what? Don't answer that. Okay, Tim, that brings us to the music video. That is to say, is there anything you want to say about the music video?
There's a couple of things, because we're going to describe essentially what happens, and it's not much.
Sure.
Did you see how many views this has on YouTube?
No, okay. I didn't.
Care to take a guess?
34 million.
Guess a little higher. Let me say this. Guess slightly more than 30 times higher.
Wait, what? 300 million?
No, that would be 10 times higher, Garrett. 30 times higher. This has 1,147,418,267 views on YouTube. Probably a few more now. The music video itself, though, it's mostly just the band playing in... I say that it's 90s cliches, but this was very early 90s, so people might have copied this and made these things cliches, but Linda...
Tim, we're going to get specific, but some of it is not not 90s cliches. Some
of it's insane.
Yeah, let me start over. They are 90s cliches because in the early to mid 90s transition from the 80s rock scene to anything that wasn't grunge, people weren't really sure what to do. And so from that perspective, there was a lot of business, a lot of wacky business. And this woman, Larry, all the wacky business.
Oh, yeah. She is dressed up like she's in that sequel to The Shining, you know, the hat lady with the top hat.
Oh,
and you got the Mad Max goggles on the top hat. And
yeah, that's what I was going to say. She was some sort of Furiosa character.
Absolutely, yeah. And she's got like a children's movie witch dress. And
oh, I thought it was a utility kilt. That works.
Yeah, either way. But like, then there's untied, like Doc Martin type boots, probably not exactly Doc Martens, with socks pulled way up above those.
This probably was a trend-setting look.
Possibly, yes. But yeah, it's mostly just the band like literally playing this in a room. Sometimes they're on a carousel. There's lots of denim. There's some skateboarding. There's some weird wall paintings. Singing into a crystal ball instead of a microphone.
There it is.
There's Skittles.
So many Skittles. Taste the rainbow. Find the feed.
Yeah.
Boy, Tim, did we rip that off?
No, they ripped that off from us.
Sounds right.
No, I mean, not from the show, but when you used to work at Skittles Incorporated, you used to walk around saying, find the feed, and no one knew why.
Right. Because the show didn't exist yet.
Right.
There was a feed, though.
Well, there's always a feed.
Right. I mean, we've got these cameras these are much better cameras, but we've had a camera on us for what, 11 years?
I'm sorry, what?
Anything else about the music video you want to say?
There's somebody in the background that reminds me of Chris Novoselic.
All right. Glad we got that in there. Tim, how did this thing do?
Well, Gart, this song did pretty well. It only hit number 14 on the US Billboard Hot 100, but it was a number one single in Austria, the Belgian Ultra Top 50 Flanders chart, on the Denmarkian IFPI, Eurochart Hot 100, the official German charts, Iceland's Icelandic Listen Top 40, Ireland, whatever theirs is, Norway VG Listen, Sweden's Sverige Top Listen, the Swiss Schweizer Hit Parade, and of course, Garrett, this was number one in the Dutch. It was actually the best-selling song in the Dutch in 1993, although it was only the 50th best-selling song in the U.S. Now, it was certified gold in the U.S.
Who was right?
It was certified gold in the U.S. with 700,000 copies sold, platinum in the Dutch, double platinum in Germany, where it sold over 1 million copies there alone. The album itself went platinum, accumulating sales of 1.5 million copies in the U.S. and 6 million copies worldwide. But that's not the important part, Garrett. Tom Geertie, I don't know how to say his name, Tom Geertie, who you may know best as Scott Smalls in The Sandlot, sings a few lines of this as Matt Turner in the 1994 film Lassie. Now, he would later go on to portray Sergeant Ed Urich in Black Hawk Down, which is a very dissimilar movie to both The Sandlot and Lassie, and in 2013 was arrested at Bush Intercontinental Airport in Houston, Texas, after he was told he was too drunk to board a flight and then subsequently headbutted a police officer. Now, that is what happens when you grow up with Dennis Leary as your stepfather.
You're killing me, Smalls. Jesus Christ. Ah, man, I remembered all those things as you said them, but could never have recited them in the order you did. That's fantastic. God. Man, Tim, what fascinates me is not just the myriad of countries from which you read off the how it did, but the variety of charts that you managed to find within the same country. My favorite, definitely the Schweizer Hit Parade. I just like the term Hit Parade.
Yes, there's several that are very European, and I like that quite a bit.
Welcome to the Hit Parade. Yeah, it's seems like a good, scary time.
Absolutely.
Great. Tim, that's how it did. What do people think of it?
Well, Garrett, would you like to know what Robert Christgau thought of it?
My sweet dandy Jesus, I would absolutely love to. Tim, are we going to play the game?
Absolutely. And this is technically for Bigger, Better, Faster, More. However, this might be the only song on it, so I think it works.
No, it's almost certainly the same song over and over. Possibly different takes. Possibly not.
Probably not. I wouldn't. I mean, why?
Actually, while I'm thinking about it, Tim, I did read a funny anecdote about this song in particular. They did not like the producer. Did you read about this?
Yeah, afterward, this was part of why Larry said she didn't like the first record.
Yeah, it was recorded by this dude named David Tingle. Tingle?
Tingle.
Tickle. Tickle? Tingle or Tickle?
I don't know.
Tickle.
Either
it's
way.
It's Tickle. Eh. David Tickle. And That might be the shirt. Just in a fine cursive David Tickle. No, actually, Tim, I am going to start. It's going to be part of the fashion label because we are, I mean, let's face it, moguls, media moguls at least, going to start branching out into streetwear. I want to give you an opportunity to invest, which, I mean, I guess it's just my money, so whatever. Let's use it as a way to justify the money you're going to take from me. Anyway, going to start a new brand. We only sell one shirt. It just says, "Don't tell Deborah."
Oh, I like that. I don't get it, yeah, but I like it.
We're going to launch the brand, Don't Tell Deborah. This is for real, folks. It will appear on the website. There will be a store where you can purchase your very own Don't Tell Deborah shirt. I haven't finished the designs yet, so keep on the lookout. More updates to come. But
now, is that a reference from the past or the future?
The future. That is a future inside joke that we are all going to be a part of in the next 10 to 20 years.
Okay, well, let's play the Robert Christgau game.
Tim is going to read a review from said crazy person, Robert Christgau, who is, of course, the godfather of rock. What's he call himself?
The godfather of rock critics, Garrett.
That makes more sense.
sure does, but also not a lot of sense.
No, because his critiques are often meandering, if not confusing, and very often have nothing to do with the actual rating that he gives at the end of the review. So Tim's going to read that review. I'm going to attempt to guess what the rating is, and then we're all going to have a good laugh when I'm either way off or exactly on with a crazy person.
All right. This is what Robert Christgau had to say. Except maybe for a few pie-eyed corner cutters over in marketing. Nobody born before Nevermind the Bollocks thinks Linda Perry is alternative. It was to avoid music that might distract from her big, vague voice. Reference. People she never heard of like Lydia Pence and people you wish she'd never heard of like Ann Wilson that she axed her female guitarist for a male hotshot once her male producer took her aside. Janis is dead, unfortunately. Also, unfortunately, her vision of a meaningful rebellion lives on. Garrett, based solely on that review for this album or possibly song, what does Robert Christgau think of Four Non Blondes and What's Up?
Well, it didn't seem overly positive. I'll say that.
Possibly. Maybe that was very positive.
Sure, sure. As I said, seem. I want to applaud you for the delivery there. The stammering approach and mispronunciation of all the words really did help to capture the madness.
Well, listen, I'm going to edit that all together so it sounds like I had read that ahead of time. Also, the problem with reading a Robert Christgau review. It's like reading one of our listener mail. The words are not quite, they're in generally the right order, but not exactly the right order.
They do not follow the conventional rules of grammar.
Exactly. So you start reading, and unless you have like read and edited these things ahead of time, there's going to be some stammering.
Sure. And I think that's how he'd prefer it be read. Okay. Based on that review, Tim, I'm going to give this, that is to say, Robert Christgau gave this a D.
Robert Christgau gave this a C.
Wow. I almost went D+. I still feel pretty good about it, though.
Yeah. There are 387 ratings on Amazon, 4.8 out of 5 stars on average, 83% 5 star, 1% 1 star. Dee Dee said, "I love this woman's spirit and performance. She has soul." And this is from 2021.
Oh, wow.
"She's so visually expressive. I love her voice. I always say this world is a better place because of people like you. I think that about my kids, my friends, people who are living in the moment every day. May she be blessed."
And Linda Perry.
May she be blessed and live in the moment. 5 out of 5 stars.
I'm picturing a woman who says her prayers every night, and that's adorable in and of itself, but she says, "And God bless Nana and Pop Pop and my children, Jackie, Peter, Billy, and Susan, and Jesus, God bless Linda Perry." Tim, do you say, you don't say any prayers at night,
you
right?
You hear me say them. We say
Santa,
a prayer.
I hear you. We do not. We do not.
Okay.
I sleep dangerously close to you in a separate bed.
Not at night. Not at night. Before the show.
Oh, yes.
I'm so sorry.
Yes. Before every episode, of course, we say a prayer. Yeah. Now, it's non-denominational, and there's always a blood sacrifice.
Sure. But it's non-denominational, but very specifically to Jesus Christ.
Sure. Well, he's the one that demands the blood. Read your Bible.
Yes.
that guy doesn't even appear for the first half of that thing.
That's true. More than that, probably. This is from Stacey Hayes. She titled her review, "What's Going On?"
I hate Stacey.
From 2013. Love this song. Now more than I did back then. Was at Office Depot the other day, and it was on in the store, and almost every aisle I walked down, a person would be humming or singing it. 5 out of 5 stars. Now, here's the interesting thing about
that. What nightmare would she
in? No. Garrett, this makes total sense. She's walking around singing it. She's just hearing her own voice.
Okay.
She's wandering in Office Depot singing this song and being like, it's like being in a music video. Everyone's singing along with me. They are not.
Or she was in some sort of Black Mirror-like scenario where everybody's slowly droning and singing that song. long inside of a, I don't know. It sounded like she visited, what's that fucking place called?
Spain.
No, would you say Spain? No, not Spain. Not Limbo, where you're trapped forever.
Purgatory.
Thank you. Yes, that sounded like she may have stumbled into purgatory, where people are forced to endlessly stock shelves for products that no one's going to possibly come in and purchase. Who's been in an Office Depot? Listeners, write in. HeyPodMail@gmail.com. Have you been in an Office Depot in the last 5 years? What's happening in there? Were they singing What's Up?
Let me ask this. Do you believe that people can write Amazon reviews from purgatory? Or do they have to write them from purgatory? No. Maybe all of these reviews are from purgatory.
I would certainly make everything make a lot more sense, and I'd feel a lot less bad for these people. No, what I am implying is she stumbled into purgatory unknowingly.
And then came back out to write this.
Yeah, classic pocket dimension, too.
Yep, adds up. Here's the most confusing one. This is by A456 from 2015. Mission Impossible. Don't sing along or watch the music video and don't get aroused. Told you, it's impossible to do. 5 out of 5 stars. Is there anything arousing about that video?
No. I mean, hey, maybe if you're just... I'm not going to say nobody has ever been attracted to Linda Perry. I personally am not. She looks like Steven Tyler to me, but...
Sure.
Which is not my jam.
No.
More of a blonde man myself. Anyway.
You are not blonde. Stop telling people you are blonde.
No, you fucking asshole. Interested in blonde women. What's
wrong with
you?
See, that's something you don't need to know. Like, that's weird.
What do you mean?
Well, it's like you can tell in your voice, like that guy's into blondes. It's odd.
Wait.
I'm just saying you're projecting. You are broadcasting your weird sexual tastes.
No, I'm not. I am answering your question.
I did not ask about that question.
You asked, is there anything arousing about the music video?
Mm-hmm. And you decided to tell me that you are only aroused by blondes.
Didn't say only, first of all.
That is threatening.
I'll show you threatening.
I think that's an in conversation. I think that's already an in conversation. But if not, September 14th, 2021, 6:36 p.m., I'll show you threatening. Garrett Harvey, in conversation.
Gino, mark the time. We're going to cut all this out.
No, we're not.
It was definitely me threatening you.
That's why we're keeping it on tape.
No, that's why it's got to go.
Okay. Great reviews, Tim.
No.
Adequate and more recent than they should be.
Yeah, all of that's confounding, and I appreciate it. That brings us to final thoughts. What have we not said about this?
Nothing. It's
dare I ask, who is this song for?
It's for people in 92. Like, it doesn't really...
93, right?
93. I think the album came out in 92. Maybe the single came out in 93. It doesn't matter. The point is...
Nope, doesn't.
That it's... This doesn't make sense after 95. Like, there's no reason to listen to this.
I agree, completely. But I do a lot.
No, yeah, I know.
And that's okay.
It's not okay.
Oh,
okay. It's okay for the listeners to listen. It's not okay for you. You've got to make...
You know what?
Oh, what?
That's fair. Okay. Tim, I got to ask it. Have we been all the way through it inside and out, really giving it a fair shake, I'd say. Do you hate this song?
No, I think this is one where I kind of just meh it. I don't ever need to listen to this again. I don't ever plan to listen to this again. I'm sure I'll hear it a number of times in your car / from your lips. But no, I don't hate it. Just don't care. What about you?
Boy, it would be crazy if I came in with a surprise hate. That'd be awesome. No,
it'd be perfectly reasonable. It's a hateable song.
No, it's not hateable. I think it's meh-able for sure. No, I still have joy for it. And I heard it, 22, 24 songs? 24 times this week? Yeah, 24 times this week. Now, I remain unchanged. I'm a little tired of it. I'm going to give it a break. But then you're right, Tim. In a year from now, you're going to hear it in the car, at the house, on the boat, pretty much everywhere.
Oh, yeah, we should announce that. We got a podcast boat.
We should not announce that.
Oh.
We should not announce that. That was a secret boat.
Well, you just said the boat. Okay, all right.
Tim, at the top of every single meeting about the boat, what did it say?
Don't talk about the boat.
Don't talk about the boat. You could say you're sorry.
I'm not sorry, though.
I think it's
cool that I have access to a boat on weekday mornings.
Sure. Wait, don't take the boat out without me. Do not do that.
Anyway, so you don't hate it. I don't hate it. We have a boat, but you're not allowed on it. And by you,
and we're not supposed to talk about it.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm selling the boat.
Okay. That brings us to listener mail, Tim. You want to go first or you want me to?
Oh, I definitely want to go first, Garrett.
All right.
This is from Evan. Dear Timot, and to a less intelligent extent, Garethy. I finished listening to your Pinkerton episode mere hours ago, and your lack of guitar amp knowledge left me supremely vexed. So I felt compelled to write in and let you know that you're the big dumb. Guitar amps can pick up radio signals if there's a problem in the amp, or if the cable to the guitar / guitar's control cavity and then in parentheses, hole where the zappy bits go, is unshielded. Mm-hmm. The latter can act as a sort of antenna and seeing as it's piped into the amplifier circuit, when the antenna is blasted with radio waves, those get spit out the amp and voila. You have the main Wheeze's sorry excuse for why he didn't cut a Korean radio show out of his dumb song or something.
Well, I take a lot of issue with this because this is shots fired directly at me, Tim.
Right.
I don't disagree with anything that this person has said. And I'm sorry I didn't catch the name.
Evan.
I wasn't listening.
It was Evan.
Still wasn't.
And just
nope, didn't hear it.
I think it's really petty of you to not give him a name.
Unfortunately, I just didn't hear it when you said it. So I'll have to just say this person is 100% right. And hey, that's a great place to start. Where I want to make a distinction is that I meant, maybe I didn't articulate it properly. I can own this as well. What I meant is that there's no goddamn way it happened to be an Asian radio program. Oh, it just happened to be a giant human-sized jar filled with the remains of a Japanese woman. I don't know. Must have been the previous owners.
Mm-hmm. He goes on. IMHO, and then in parentheses, in my humble opinion, you old farts. That's just laziness on the part.
Hold on. I need to take umbrage once again with this person.
We're
going to
be here forever.
Shut up. This person, and maybe I am the old, but I could have sworn it was in my honest opinion, not my humble opinion. Am I wrong here?
Internet? You're an old fart. I believe it's in my humble opinion.
Is it? Well,
it might be honest. Who knows? Maybe Evan's wrong. Maybe he's wrong about this whole thing. The point is,
who's Evan?
IMHO. IMHO, that's just laziness on the part of the big Wheeze, but TBH doesn't define that one, so we have no way of knowing what that means. It
sure
fits his Asian sucker vibe, so it works. New show hashtag, Cuomo sucks Asians, could make it... Could make it just hashtag Cuomo jars women, as that would be multi-purpose, as apparently there are a few dysfunctional Cuomos running around right now. Anyways, I'm wine drunk and tired, so I'm going to bed. Thanks for being funny and dorky. P.S. Garrett, my boy, your solo casts on Van Zant were fabulous. Some of your finest solo cast work. Keep it up. Put Tim back in... Oh, God damn it. Put Tim... Evan, I don't care for this. Put Tim back in that cutlass trunk and do some more of that soon, would ya? Peace, Evan. And then, P.P.S. Regarding Rivers Cuomo, as Tim used to say, and I do agree with this, that is what happens when you take prayer out of schools.
Fair. Wait, no. Not fair.
It is. It is. Scared. If they enforced prayer like they oughta, we wouldn't be dealing with Rivers Cuomo. No. Anyway, Garrett, do you have mail?
Of course I have mail. It's a segment we have every week.
Garrett, what mail do you have?
Actually, I have two.
Nah, I just read one. You can save one for next week.
But the second one is like two sentences.
All right, read both of those and then I have another one.
This email is titled Sneaky Sneaky Ska and it's from Patrick. Patrick writes, hello, lads. I've been a frequent listener for about a year now, and I have even converted a friend, Juan Lucini Garino, he's okay with you using his name, well, that's good, to the Why I Hate This Album, Way of Life, oh no. He has no idea what ska is, but believes it's probably pretty bad. I was talking to said friend, and we were discussing some bands we loved, and then he brought up one of his favorite bands of all time, the Aquabats. I see where this is going. He didn't believe me when I told him they were ska, as he didn't want to accept that he had trash music tastes.
Hmm.
After convincing him that they were ska, I was laughing at him for being a lifelong Aquabats fan. I continued to find out he is a massive fan of Real Big Fish and Less Than Jake as well. He hates Sublime, though. He never knew that they were all ska. And then it just says, do XXX Temptations album 17. The cover is literally his 17-year-old poetry. It's perfect. Oh, that's not bad. Maybe we'll have to do that, Patrick. Fantastic that a guy was a lifelong fan of ska while simultaneously hating ska. My second one, Tim, is very short. It's from Nathan. It's entitled Fan Mail. We don't use that word around here. We prefer listener or viewer. Find the feed. He writes, thank you for the podcast. I was turned onto it just this week and have torn my way through many episodes since. It's refreshing to find a most intelligent and articulate hate. I applaud your cathartic hatred, gentlemen. Thank you very much, Nathan. But the reason, Tim, the reason I wanted to read this is a fascinating idea. He says, I have a request, if I may. I would love to sit down with my favorite artist, Prince. Perhaps the Batman soundtrack is the one to look at. That has aged somewhat in the years of superhero soundtracks, bizarre mashups, and stray quotes. And then he quotes, hey, Ducky, let me stick this 7-inch in the computer, end quote. All the best, keep bustin', which I believe is a Ghostbusters reference.
I hope so, but sure. I don't know.
I mean, maybe he's encouraging at least me. I don't know what you do in your personal life. It's none of my business to continue ejaculating. I don't know any other term for bustin'.
We'll say it's the Ghostbusters thing.
Yeah, let's stick with the Ghostbusters thing. So Tim, not next week, but let's get it on the list. What do you think? The Batman soundtrack by Prince is fascinating.
Yeah, I'm in.
And weird.
He should have done weird. Batman Returns, too.
I think
it's because it's a very, like, it has a very different feel to it. It would be interesting to see Prince do an album for that as well.
Yeah. I mean, it barely works with the neo-gothic style of the first one. And the second one, my God. The best thing about that movie is that McDonald's tried to have Happy Meal toys, and they're just like, these are terrifying.
Yeah. This guy also eats don't raw let fish kids, and vomits yeah, bile.
Don't let kids see this movie. Anywho.
Danny DeVito is a national treasure.
He really is. I will say we should maybe do a little bit of research. We may want to do a prepisode and stick only to Bat Dance. There's a good chance listening to that entire album could take like 80 minutes.
Could be. We won't guarantee we're going to do it, but we'll probably do it.
Yeah, probably.
I'll keep guarantee busting. It. Yeah, let's end with that.
What? And what with?
Everything. With all conversations.
All conversations. So at the end of this conversation, we'll end with keep busting.
Yes.
This has been Why I Hate This Album. Keep busting.
I love it.
Okay. All right, Tim. That brings us to Music News of the Weird. You want to kick things off or you want me to?
I will kick things off.
Music News of the Weird.
In Chuck Klosterman was wrong when he said ABBA would never tour again news. ABBA is going to tour again, Garrett. They have not had an album in 40 years, and they're going to release an album called Voyage in November 2021, and then they're going to do a resident show in London with motion-captured digital avatars of their members starting in May 2022. We could go to London and see, I don't know, Ghost ABBA? What's happening? Yeah. What is this?
And see giraffes perform yeah. ABBA?
Dude, you know what's crazy, though, is given what they're planning on doing, Tupac could show up.
That would be incredible.
Yeah, because I think their music actually goes together better than people think. Somebody make that mashup.
I mean, really, anybody could show up. Tupac, Batman.
Batman's still alive, Garrett. He could show up anywhere. He could show up anywhere. He could be here right now.
Sorry. Batman's still alive?
Did you hear on the news that Batman was dead? What are you talking about?
What are you talking about? Where's Batman?
He's everywhere. That's what you have to worry about. He's always watching. Yeah.
From the shadows, right. Okay, well, it's too late in the episode for me to possibly try to figure out what you're talking about. Right. So we'll continue.
Well, why don't you give us a news story then? Something Batman related, perhaps.
Nope. Well, let's see.
Excellent.
No. The segment is Music News of the Weird, and not always is it so weird, but I think I've got a good one this week. It's a tragic one, though. It's about the death of a man named Mick Brigden. Did you hear about the death of Mick Brigden?
No.
Well, Mr. Brigden was the tour manager for stars such as Van Morrison, Humble Pie, Peter Frampton, Carlos Santana, and the Rolling Stones.
Let me take that again. Yes. Yes, I did.
Fantastic. He was a protege of Bill Graham. He spent 7 years working under Graham before taking over the management division of the company Bill Graham Presents. From there, he went on to start a record company of his own. He had a long and storied career in the music industry, working with several big names. Sadly, September 7th, Brigden was digging a grave for his 14-year-old dog, Travis, who was in poor health and not eating. While digging the grave, the hole collapsed on Brigden, and he was described to TMZ as a freak accident that, quote, left him dead immediately, end quote. Oh, hold on. There is a small PS. Travis the dog was put down 2 days after Brigden's death.
Jesus Christ. This isn't a good story.
It is music related and it is weird as shit.
That's
how
true.
Deep was that grave well, for a dog?
Also, here's the really troubling thing. If your dog's sick, don't dig the grave before your dog dies. That's really weird.
Also, really weird. Yeah. Oh, everything about it. Listen, I feel horrible for this family, but it doesn't sound...
It doesn't add up exactly.
Because it sounds like a murder. It sounds like a murder. I'm saying it. If it was, it sounds like a sloppy murder.
Allegedly.
The point is,
don't dig a grave for anyone or anything that you know that is alive. That's just weird.
Do you think anyone's ever buried a plant?
Yes, but it's really just planting it.
Right. You're off the show.
Excellent. I wish I knew it was that easy.
You're on the show. Oh. All right. Tim, what other news about people dying suspiciously in a hole do you have?
Well, Garrett, in dumb news this week, Spencer Eldon. Are you familiar with Spencer Eldon?
Not off the top of my head. Give me some context.
He was the baby on the cover of Nirvana's Nevermind.
Oh, Christ. I can't believe we're going to talk about this. All right, do it.
We have to, though, because this is also genuinely weird. He is suing the band and I think the lawsuit names 16 different individuals, so presumably some record executives, etc. And he is claiming sexual exploitation. The lawsuit accuses the defendant, and I'm going to do some quotes here, of commercial child exploitation of him from when he was a minor to the present day, with the defendants knowingly producing, possessing, and advertising commercial child pornography depicting Spencer. He claims the image is sexually graphic and says it makes him resemble, and I'm quoting here again, a sex worker grabbing for a dollar bill. The lawsuit claims that he was never paid for appearing on the cover and that his parents never signed a release form for the image, which was shot specifically for the album cover. It was previously reported that he was paid $250. And this whole thing is, of course, despite Eldon periodically cashing in on this whole thing, including repeatedly recreating the image for the New York Post in the Rolling Stone, one of which I do think he was a minor for. So if you're going to sue somebody, maybe those people.
Right. No, it's if he had never benefited himself from it, I think you'd have a really rock solid case. Now, as a person who is, of course, not a lawyer, I have not passed the bar in most states, but the way laws are written, none of that might matter. Like, just letter of the law. Yep.
Yeah, but I mean,
I'm not saying he's right. No one's saying he's right. I'm just saying, could you prove it? Like, say, did this happen? Is it technically legal? No.
I think it is, though.
Oh, maybe it is.
Because it's not,
for artistic reasons or something?
Yeah, again, it's artistic reasons / like, I don't know, it's a baby.
Tim, I
don't know.
Don't really want to wade into these waters. And that's kind of why we're both just kind of talking out of our ass. Neither of us have really ever looked into the details of how naked can you make a baby photo. Because not really pertaining to our lives. But yeah, sure. It's a question. Obviously, it's not a problem. It's been printed and reprinted bajillions of time, so nobody seems to care.
Yes,
because obviously it's not pornography, it's an album cover. But I'm just saying, if somebody were to say, well, look at the way the laws are written, does this match this, they might go, well, fuck, yes it does.
I assume it probably falls under some sort of statute of limitations thing, because I don't think Clapton is worried about anyone coming up for that. I forget which album it is. It's some random group that he was in the mid to late 70s that had a like 13-year-old topless girl on the cover for some reason.
Yeah, that does sound like a thing that happened.
Yeah. Anyway, Garrett, what other news havest thou for us this week?
You're making this segment worse every week.
Yeah, I don't like it. I'm trying to end.
All right. In Metallica gets less cool every year news, recently Metallica's lead singer, James Hetfield, became tearful in an interview in which Elton John described Nothing Else Matters as, quote, one of the best songs ever written. The band was appearing with Miley Cyrus on the Howard Stern Show on September 9th when they were gathered via Zoom with Mr. Elton John. They were all there to promote the rendition of Nothing Else Matters appearing on the Metallica Blacklist album, the recently released charity album showcasing a cover from 53 different artists of tracks of Metallica's Black Album in celebration of its 30th anniversary. Tim, have you heard any of these yet?
I listened to the Portugal the Man one.
Is it any good?
Eh.
Fair enough. There's a lot on there, so I'm sure there's a few that are quite good.
Oh, there's a Weezer one. Anyway, Tim, go ahead.
I'm thinking we've got our prepisode material for the next Well, what's wild is that I was looking at the track listings, like Enter Sandman, there's 6 different Enter Sandmans.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be maddening
to
listen to.
It's not that long of an album. For 53 covers. If we did, Jesus.
What if we did that album as an episode? That'd be that's the final episode.
I've got a different idea. So 53 songs, you said.
Yeah.
That's 1 year and 1 week's worth of material. Done.
Oh my God. And it's probably not 53 tracks because it's 53 different artists, but let's say 50-ish plus the Insane Clown Posse Christmas.
Let's not ever listen to it.
Fair enough. Let's go with that. So continuing on, Sir Elton, said, listen, this is one of the best songs ever written to me. It's a song that that never gets old. And playing on this track, I just couldn't wait. The chord structure, the melodies, the time changes, it's got drama written all over it. And at this moment, Hetfield can be seen welling up and wiping tears away from his face, while Elton John continues, I have to say it, it's a no-brainer playing on this song. Metallica are probably the creme de la creme of those kinds of bands. You can't really define them. They're not a heavy metal band, they're a musical band. Their songs aren't just heavy metal, they're beautiful songs. This is such a melodic song. It's fucking great, actually. Elton John's a weirdo.
He is.
Yeah, so just shockingly, Kirk Hammett, not the weepy-eyed fellow in the interview, James Hetfield taking the lead role as chief crier for Metallica.
Is it possible Kirk Hammett was not there?
Ooh, he was a designated crier.
Yes. Now, I think this story works a lot better if every statement that Elton John says is punctuated by a yeah.
Easy there, James. Yeah, yeah. What other news you got, Timbo?
Well, Garrett, in Thanos news, and a story that we previously broke, this was a Why I Hate This Album exclusive at the time, little Uzi Vert got a diamond implanted in his forehead like a silly bitch. It was a $24 million pink diamond, and very recently he went crowd surfing like a guy that did not have a forehead diamond just loosely attached to his forehead, and allegedly Josh Brolin just ripped the thing out of his forehead.
Now, was it Josh Brolin or Thanos?
Well, I mean, it was Josh Brolin. Thanos isn't real.
As Thanos,
I mean,
though?
He was still in character, clearly, but I think it was more of a method acting thing. I don't think there was any makeup or computer-generated face testicles involved.
Did he have the glove?
Oh, yeah, of course, Garrett. Josh Brolin has not taken that glove off. The point, though...
I am inevitable. Okay, Josh.
Well, but here's the thing. If you hear that and you've got a diamond in your forehead, you get a lot more scared. We should all kind of thank Josh for this because he taught us a valuable lesson about leaving our valuables just lying about in our foreheads for just anyone to take.
Absolutely. I certainly will be removing all of the jewelry from my forehead this evening, lest it be ripped out by a mad titan. We should also admit, Tim, a man reported to look like James Brolin. Reported to look. We did not see this happen.
Oh, sure. Right.
Could have been Bronson Pinchot, for all we know.
I don't know what that is.
He's the character from, you know what, who gives a shit?
Well, edit that to pretend I knew what you were talking about.
No way. It's much better. Bronson Pinchot, deep cut. Listeners, write in. Did you watch Perfect Strangers? Or, I guess, Beverly Hills Cop. Yep. Anyway.
I would like to move on. What other news do you have, Garrett?
You know what? I think my last news story isn't very good, so I will pass it back to you, Tim. Do you have any other news that you must reveal?
The only other thing I would like to say is that Jamie Spears has filed a petition to terminate the Britney conservatorship / slavery agreement with the U.S. government. Mm. Presumably, once he stepped down, he thought, well, if I'm not getting all that money, why bother? And sure. So he's attempting to get it. So we might, actually, this very show might have done some good in the world.
Might have freed Britney. We did it, everyone.
Yep.
Let's get the banner. Mission accomplished.
Oh, man. I think it was very funny. I don't know how much it cost to get the actual banner at auction from the Navy, but it was worth it.
Not much, shockingly. Because I bought it, Tim, right after they used it. You'd be shocked how quickly they wanted to get rid of that thing.
That's fair.
Eddie Hoozle. All right, Tim. That brings us to the part of the show that we all anticipate. I mean, let's just say it, in our loins. This is the part where we announce what album we're going to be listening to for an entire fucking week. And then we're going to come back here and we're going to tell you why we do or do not hate it. So, Tim, you have selected the ping pong ball from the tumble machine and you know what album we're going to be listening to. I do not yet know. Reveal to the listeners and myself, what are we in for?
Next week, we will be listening to the Spin Doctors 1991 debut album, Pocket Full of Kryptonite. This was suggested, according to the ping pong ball, by Ian W. in what appears to be an email from over a year ago that I don't think either of us responded to. So, Ian, this is responding to you technically. And it was also suggested by Mick, aka Mick or Astro Mick, I believe, on Instagram, who suggested we listen to Two Princes, but instead he's getting another 9 Spin Doctor songs. So, fuck you, Mick. Little Miss can't be wrong.
Oh, man. Oh, man.
It sounds like you know this well.
Oh, man. I know it well. Know
gonna,
it well.
You're going to like this, I think.
I may not even listen to it till, like, I don't know, Monday.
But you still have to listen to it 10 times, so you should probably start earlier.
No way, Tim. Back to back. Back to back. Oh, that's good. No, this will ruin it. Great time, Tim. Okay, that brings us to the end of the show where we ask, please, if you can, there's two things we ask. Three things, really. One, if you have access to the Apple Podcast app and you've not yet done so, or maybe if you have already, go out there, hit the 5 stars, get it out of the way. It takes no time whatsoever. If that's all you got time for, boom, you're done. Congratulations. If you got a little extra time and you want to get witty, throw a review in there. Get weird with it. Get inside jokes. Get mean. Tell Tim, hey, Yogi's a great dog. What a great dog. He's no Batman, though. That's the best dog ever. He's the cutest, fuzziest, most adorable dog.
And you know what? That's a plus in his column. He's no Batman.
No, it isn't. No, it isn't. Your dog, I love Yogi. I'm not going to besmirch him. I'm just going to say he's an 8. Batman's a clear 10.5.
Let me tell you something. If you continue to besmirch the name of Yogi, Yogi's going to eat your beard.
I invite it. Batman will thwart him with his beard defense.
He just sits in the corner and laughs.
Yeah. No, he's not great at beard defense.
No.
Anyway, great at hide and seek, though.
Dog runs away like crazy.
The point is, get the 5 stars, get the weird review, acknowledge how great Batman is, and Yogi's also a great dog, just a little less good. A lot less good. The second thing we ask, write in. HatePodMail@gmail.com, or you can go to HatePod.com and click on Contact Us in the upper left-hand corner. It does ask for an email. That's just so we can reply, and that's all we do. It takes us some time, but we promise we'll do it. You'd be shocked how many people reply to our reply saying, I can't believe you replied. I fucking told you I was gonna. You wrote in thinking I would, and then I did. Anyway.
But not all you can of also you.
No, not all of you. Not in due time. But listen, there are literally hundreds of emails, and there are two of us, a septuagenarian fascist, and 42 of the least useful human beings on the face of this earth. So we're getting there as best we can. Anyway, what's the third thing we ask people to do, Tim?
Check us out on OnlyFans. They now they allow nudity again. So just
that is a completely unsanctioned OnlyFans. Unsanctioned.
Unsanctioned. There's no rules whatsoever on OnlyFans.
That's not what I mean by unsanctioned. And that's not the third thing we ask people to do. The third thing we ask them to do is, oh gosh, what is it? I forgot now.
I don't know. Two's probably enough.
Sure. It's probably good enough. Oh, I remember the third one now. If you've done those two, or even if you haven't, get somebody else to listen. Just say, hey, it's a really good show. It's super weird. I can't really describe it. And if you don't like the first one, just listen to 3 more and then try to stop. We dare you. We're like heroin. The more you do it, the more you love it. You can also find us on Instagram. We're HatePod. On Twitter, we're AlbumHatePod. On Twitter, I'm Garrett. I'm not Garrett. I am Garrett. But you'll find me on Twitter at GHarveyTweets. And goddammit, you better reach out. I want to have a long, detailed conversation about music or movies or the show or Tim. He's a real person, I promise. You can try to reach out to Tim on Instagram. I won't tell you what it is, and it's private anyway because he won't let you follow him, so why bother? We're on Facebook, but we don't know how to log in because we lost the password, and we're not 80, so we don't get it onto it anyway. We don't have personal accounts because it's all full of psychopaths and liars, so don't even bother with Facebook. We got a Discord server. We don't know how it works, but we're on it from time to time. If you want to get onto it, find somebody who knows how. I'm sure they can figure it out. We also have got the subreddits, etc. We're not so much on it, but there seems to be a pretty healthy discussion going on out there. So if you want to talk about the show, that's another place to do it. And I think that's just about it. For Why I Hate This Album, I have been one of your hosts, Garrett Harvey.
I have been your other host, Timothy P. Richardson, and Garrett P. Harvey cannot tell time on an analog clock.
That's a misunderstanding. That's a misunderstanding based. The clock, it was an angle.
Where
issue.
Are the numbers? Right.
I thought it was a 3 where the 9 was, and I was confused by that. It wasn't. It was a glare. There was a glare that made the 9 look. Listen, man, I can tell time.
On a digital clock, yes.
Sure. On a digital clock, on a round face flat clock, the little hand and the big one. I do struggle with military time.
What do you think an analog clock is? It doesn't matter.
Sort of butt clock.
Jesus Christ.
You've brought us to this level.
Mm-hmm.
Not me.
Mm-hmm.
There's cowboys running through my dreams. Nothing's quite the way it seems. I joined the Navy, got kicked out in a week. My facial features aren't distinct. try to find some meaning in these songs. The genius is a genius, got it wrong. No, it's a lobster murder sex thing. It's the bleaching of the rear. A full assault on both your ears. The riffs are too repetitive. The lyrics make no sense. All the songs are B-sides. The cover art's a mess. Listen to it. Tim and Gary.
Keep bustin'.
Oh, of course, keep on bustin'. Dive on in.